Hello everyone and welcome to the Vegan Gorilla and Chums. I want to thank everybody for supporting the podcast so far since it's came back. And today we've got a very special guest. It's Kevin L. Johnson. You may know him as Sam from Ozark. And if you don't know what Ozark is, if you've never watched that before, then there's nothing I can do to help you, I'm afraid, because it's one of the best shows out right now. And that is like someone telling me that they've not seen The Godfather or The Goodfellas or something. Go and get yourself help. Kevin, how are you, mate?
I'm doing well, man. How are you?
Yes, I am well. I'm a wee bit nervous, actually, because I haven't really been speaking to many people outside my friends and family, so this is quite surreal.
I know. It's. I promise I don't have the virus, though, so we should be okay. And plus, you know, we're like, we're miles and miles apart.
Yeah. So you can you can understand my Scottish accent. Okay, I don't need subtitles for you.
I was wondering if I was going to be able to, but so far, good.
So far, so good. So we've got a clip of you in Ozark. I'm going to get Andrew to play that, and we'll show the audience a wee clip from Ozark.
Cool.
Can I speak with you for a moment?
Sure. What's this all about?
Math. I'm good at math. Probabilities, abstractions. And by my calculation, you've lost $250,000, give or take.
Yeah, you're not gonna tell my girlfriend, are you?
No. But I am gonna have to re-examine your financials. Bank statements, pay stubs, all that fun stuff.
Wait, you can do that?
If I suspect illegal activity.
Yeah, but I'm not doing anything illegal. I'm just losing, you know?
Well, then you have nothing to worry about. Also, you'll be hearing from the IRS.
Fantastic. Well, it's a fantastic show. It's going worldwide. People are absolutely loving it. And Sam reminds me of, you know, that type of friend that you have that's your best friend, but you also hate him and he kind of annoys you. Like, he's that type of guy.
Okay.
He's got a kind of childlike quality about him that you just feel like, what are you doing? Don't do that. But it's a fantastic character you play. And does it remind you of anyone in your life, or do you take bits of characters from other people that you know, or is it kind of like you a wee bit?
I always say that that Sam is kind of like me, you know, just like heightened. You know, I can tap into that that kind of quality, you know, the naivete and the innocence. Like, those are kind of easy qualities for me to tap into because I've always been, you know, like, people I know have always seen me as like this good, nice guy, you know, sometimes has that innocent quality. So it's just, it's, I don't know whether that was the plan for Sam, because when I got the role, it was, I think it was like 2 or 3 episodes. And then they just kept writing me in, and I think they just fell in love with what I was bringing to the role. So it's just been awesome getting to see this, you know, character arc, like going from a mama's boy to helping Wendy out to finding love in the craziest of places, like a strip club. And then, you know, season 3, you know, getting involved in some of the scams. And yeah, it's been a blast.
Yeah, it's amazing to see a character growth like that. And I don't really want to say any spoilers, but if it's coming back for a season 4, do you think, it seems like the way that it ended, it looks like Sam is going to be involved more and perhaps have a bigger part in Ozark?
I mean, I hope so. Yeah. I'm not one of the writers, you know, so.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I feel good about it. I think they've created Sam, and you know, he has more of a following each season. I think people love the character, so you know, I hope that they stretch out his role a bit, but you never know. I mean, it kind of just depends on what they have planned for the next season. If we get, you know, officially picked up, we haven't officially gotten picked up yet. Feel good about it, but you know.
Oh yeah, fantastic. I mean, I've got some questions here from some fans, but I'll ask you them later on. I forgot to mention my mustache as well. I hope you know. I hope you don't think that that's a normal part of my life. It's just a lockdown boredom mustache. Just in case I'm scaring you, or you think this is a Scottish sex cult or something.
No, you're good. I was growing something that it just annoys me, so I shave it down as much as I can without using like the razor and, you know, just like a beard trimmer. That's what I do.
I see you've not went to the stage of just going crazy and shaving all your hair off yet, because most of the guys around the world are doing that, aren't they? They're just
I can't. My job, unfortunately, I mean, I don't know how I would look good with a shaved head anyways, but I got a project that I got to start back on when we get back up, and if I shave my head, they'd be like, I don't know what we're going to be able to do now, you know.
Yeah. Ozark comes back for a season 4 and everyone in the cast has got a skinhead. That'd be quite strange.
That's a totally different show.
I was looking through, I've been looking through your CV and stuff, and just, I was doing some research on you. Obviously, we followed each other on Twitter for a long time, and I'm a fan anyway, but just for purposes of the podcast, I was just looking through your stuff, and you have a very impressive CV. You've been working for a long time. You're a proper working actor. Maybe lot of people would just think, oh, he's just like, maybe Ozark is his first gig, but if you go onto your internet movie database, you've got something like 41 credits.
Is it 41?
Oh, wow. I think so. I think it's up there.
Huh. Yeah, I mean, Ozark is definitely the biggest. I've done a lot of what they call like the day players, co-star roles on TV shows. And then I've been in a couple movies. I've got American Made, which was Tom Cruise. But I'm not actually in the movie. I'm credited in the movie, but I'm not in it, which is hilarious because my grandmother says, "Hey, I saw that movie, American Made. You were great in it." And I was like, "I saw it too. And Grandma, I don't think I was in it." "Oh no, I saw you in it. I heard you." I was like, "No, you might have been thinking of some other movie."
Yeah, grandmothers are always the biggest critics, aren't they?
Yeah.
I mean, if I was you, I would be telling everyone I was best mates with Tom Cruise. At parties and stuff. Yeah, I've got his mobile number. I phone him all the time.
Yeah, me and TC, you know, we go way back. Old Cruise.
I take it, do you ever get, I mean, maybe not your gran, but I've certainly got some family members like that, like, "Oh, you've worked with Tom Cruise. Why don't you get him up to the house for a Sunday dinner?"
Yeah, it's funny because some of, you know, the relatives think that you're actually really close with these people. And I don't have, like, Jason Bateman's cell phone number, or definitely not Tom Cruise. Because, I mean, they're probably worried about people hitting them up, like, constantly and just being like, "Hey, what's going on, dude?" And, you know, I'm sure that's one of the reasons. I didn't ask for Tom Cruise's number either, but I don't even know how I would start that conversation. Like, "Hey, bud, can we stay in contact? You know,
have you got Twitter, number. Tom? Follow me back. I'll DM you. You can get Tom on your podcast."
Yeah.
I was also, it was quite a surreal moment the other night. I was watching one of my favourite movies of all time, and it's mostly to do with the soundtrack, actually, is Prisoners. And
oh, yeah.
The soundtrack is done with Jonathan Johansson, who sadly passed away a couple of years ago. But I've seen the film maybe 5-10 times. And when I was, you know, down a Google rabbit hole with it, looking at facts and stuff, and I seen, this is when I was watching Ozark as well, and mm-hmm. I seen you had a small part in that as well. That's awesome.
Yeah, that was a really cool movie. And yeah, the music in that was really like eerie, and it, who did that? Who directed that? Oh, Denny Villanueva. I think that's how you pronounce his last name, but yeah, he's a great director. And you know, he did like the Blade Runner sequel, which was awesome. Yeah. He's doing Dune, that's coming out soon. He did Sicario, the first one.
Fantastic.
Incredible. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a great director.
Yeah, an absolute awesome movie. It just made me look at, like, I was doing some research, and I'm a stand-up comedian and I'm an actor, but it's all my work is in Scotland. Mm-hmm. And I came across a term that I've never seen before. I seen you post a clip and you said pilot season is coming up. So is pilot season in America a massive thing?
Oh, I guess it is an American thing. It's so pilot season, it's kind of changed over the years because of streaming. So technically pilot season can be like all year, but it really means like ABC, NBC, CBS, Fox, like they have a certain time during the beginning of the year. I think it's like late February to early April is something like that. Where their new shows are being created. And they're trying to cast the pilot, which is the first episode of the show. That's where the term pilot comes from.
Yeah, because we just don't have that. I mean, maybe in London, but it's only really London that all the big things like that happen, and nothing really happens like that in Scotland. So I was like quite curious to what that meant. I'd imagine that's quite a stressful time of the year. For actors, anyway?
Yeah, I mean, I haven't really gotten to experience the whole pilot season yet, because a lot of times it's the bigger actors that they're looking for. Not all the time, but to get those series regular roles that they're looking for those pilots. And a lot of times they have certain people already in mind. But yeah, it's like if you're auditioning during pilot season, it can definitely be a crazy, crazy time, because they're doing chemistry reads and you know, second, third, fourth callbacks.
Yeah.
So a lot goes into pilot season for sure, and a lot of casting directors during that time, everything else is kind of put on hold because of pilot season. So
yeah,
it can be crazy.
So how was the experience of Ozark for you? Was that one of those auditions that were numerous callbacks? Was it stressful, or was it a spur of the moment phone call from your agent? You know, because sometimes you can get things like that. But what was that like for you?
Yeah, so they're doing a lot of taped auditions, and they have been for quite some time. So yeah, I got the audition through my Southeast agent that I still have. And I put the audition on tape, sent it in, felt good about it. And then, I found out from the manager that I had at the time, that they were going to go with somebody older for the role. So I said, okay, you know, that happens. I've been in this business long enough to get rejection. And yeah. I was on my way back to Charlotte, North Carolina, to audition. It was a callback for a short film. And my agent called me while I was driving and he was like, hey, they want to book you for Ozark. And I was just like, what? So, I mean, you just never know what's going to happen. And yeah, they booked me off the tape. I didn't have a callback or anything.
It was fantastic. It was crazy.
Yeah.
So was your gran happy with that?
I don't know if my my grandma has seen it yet. She's not a big fan of those kind of shows.
Yeah.
I tell my mom, I was like, yeah, grandma's not going to want to see this. Because I yes. played Willy Wonka in college, and she just assumes that that's all I like. Oh, why can't you just do that? Why can't you just play Willy Wonka and everything? Yeah.
Yeah. The innocence of grandparents, huh?
Yeah.
I think Ozarks is such a surreal show because it's such a strong cast from, yeah. you know, kid actors, from a strong female cast as well. Mm-hmm. But to even see Jason Bateman, like someone who's known for comedy and would you even say maybe a heartthrob, all of a sudden being in this kind of crazy Ozark, you know, crime series and
yeah.
absolutely smashing it. I mean, all the cast have smashed it. That's one thing I have noticed about the show is normally when you watch Breaking Bad or The Walking Dead or something, everybody's got a favourite character. But this show, everybody's kind of equal.
Yeah, it's I definitely think it's an ensemble for sure. And you know, Jason, Laura, and Julia, who plays Ruth, are definitely the you know, that's where the show like starts and kind of branches out from there. But yeah, man, it's been great getting to work with the cast. Jason, getting to work with him in front of the camera, behind the camera. He's got such a great eye for everything. And he's such an open director too. You know, he lets you play within the box of the scene. And it's just cool watching him go from, you know, doing a scene with him and then going behind the camera to look at the scene, come back, give some notes. And the notes are always like, they're so easy to figure out. Like he's really good at being able to do that. So it's awesome getting to work with him. And then a lot of my stuff in season one was with Laura. And that was just a dream come true, getting to work opposite her. I mean, I grew up seeing her in The Truman Show. That was what I originally remember her from. And she's just done so much work. I call her like a national treasure. So getting to work with her is like, both of them is like a master class. And then getting to work with Julia in season two was a real treat. And also in season three, finding out that I was going to get to work with her in season two was really good to hear. Cause she's just like, she's taking the world by storm right now. And
yeah,
she's such a sweetheart off screen, funny, down to earth. And then on screen, she's just like a firecracker. And she just, like they all just, you know, you got to bring your A game and they bring their A game, you bring your A game. And it's just, it's great, man.
Yeah, it's a fantastic cast. Obviously, a shout out to my fellow Scotsman, Peter Mullen, who is fantastic in it.
Yeah.
But I've got a question here from someone, and I'll just ask you just now. I would say spoiler alert, but see if you haven't seen the show, get a grip of yourself. So it's from a girl called Marion Brown, and she said, do you judge her for laughing in season one when your mum got knocked down? And you said, deadpan, I'll never be able to take the trash out without thinking of her again. Now, I don't know if this is a Scottish sense of humour, but I laughed at that as well. I don't know if I was supposed to laugh, but I laughed.
Oh, no, no, you're good. No, no judgment. I think that's it's kind of like a what the fuck moment when it happens. And yeah, I mean, whatever your reaction is I, and I've gotten a lot of people that have that have found it funny because, I mean, you know, she's an overbearing mom and, you know, she's got her fingers in her ears and la-di-da-di-da-di-da. I mean, she kind of had it coming. I love Sharon. She was the one who played my mom. Awesome, awesome actor to get to work with. Beautiful person. But yeah, it just, I think it made sense, you know? It was just for Sam to progress. I think something like that had to happen.
Yeah. Because it takes me back to when I was saying Sam is he's a frustrating character because you like him, you feel sorry for him, you get annoyed sometimes as well. You feel like grabbing him and saying, come on, man, get a grip. Yeah,
it's like the whole fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me.
Yeah.
Fool me three times, I'm just an idiot.
Yeah.
Like, how many times can Wendy say, hey, can you help us out with this? And then I get, it's so crazy though, because it's like a cause and effect thing. Like if I had never met Wendy, I never would have worked at the strip club. I never would have. Now, granted, if I never met Wendy, I probably never would have lost my mom. That probably wouldn't have happened. So there's that cause and effect there. And then in season two, you know, she comes to my, my motivational speaking tour and says, hey, can you help us out? And had I not helped her out, I never would have met Jade, who's now the love of Sam's life. So yeah, everything has a cause and effect, whether it's good or bad.
So do you feel like, because you've been a working actor for a couple of years, earning a living, paying the bills, and then all of a sudden Ozark comes along and it has, obviously it must be a fun experience, but has it been surreal and has it just been crazy? Because I'm in a TV show in Scotland called Scott Squad and I don't even know if it's popular in Scotland.
I'll have to watch it. Is it on a side note, but is it on like Netflix or Amazon or is it available?
They're working on trying to get it on Netflix or Amazon Prime, but it's on YouTube and, you know, the internet. But it's one of those shows that Scottish people either love it or they don't know what it is. So what's it been like for Ozark? Have you been getting some crazy messages from people from like Argentina and stuff saying that they love you in the show?
Yeah, it's the fan base is awesome. And without the fans there would be no show. And like the word you use, surreal, is how I still see it that way. Getting recognized every now and then. I mean, obviously we're all in quarantine right now, but when season one came out, I was working at a restaurant. And it was crazy. Like I would go up to tables and, you know, take orders and things. And I'd get that look and it'd be like, do I know you? Did you work at this other restaurant? You know, and it takes them a little bit to figure out where they know me from. And then it's like, oh my God, you're the guy from Ozark. Holy cow.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's been crazy. It's opened up, more opportunities for me. But yeah, still a grind trying to get that next gig, you know?
Yeah, I'm glad you said that because, I mean, I've been a stand-up comedian for 10 years and I'm going to be honest with you, mate, I was nervous. Like, see, even the first 5 minutes of this podcast, I'm like, holy fuck, I'm talking to a guy from Ozark. But I've kind of calmed down a wee bit.
I was nervous too. I was like, I don't know how this podcast is going to go. I mean, I've done a number of them, but you get that nerve. You get nervous about at the beginning. I think that just shows that you're just like being on set, you know, it's if you're not a little nervous, then you're taking it for granted. You're not in it, so to speak.
Yeah.
So a little, There's nothing wrong with a little nerves.
Yeah. I'm glad that you said that you were working in a restaurant and stuff, because it just shows you that you're human, because maybe people would build you up to be this Hollywood actor guy that, you know, but
yeah, not
it
just yet.
Shows you that you're human. What was I going to say there? So how are you during this lockdown and quarantine? Are you keeping happy? Are you keeping okay?
Yeah, I mean, I do the CrossFit workout. I've been doing that for like a little over a year. So that's like a Monday through Saturday thing that I was doing at the gym. So now they have they give us a workout that we can do at home. So I have free weights that I use for a lot of the workouts. I go jogging. I've started the last week or so, you know, taking some pictures and putting them on Instagram and Twitter. Like my roommate, she has three cats. So sometimes I'm able to get a really good, cool pic of one of them. It's hard to do because it's not like, hey, stay still so I can take a really cool picture of you doing something really interesting right now. So sometimes I get a good pic, and then I go outside and I take some pictures of, you know, the backyard, and people have liked them on Instagram. They've been like, yeah, those are really cool shots. And I'm like, cool. Well, thanks. I mean, photography is not easy. So I'm just trying to come up with some interesting shots. So
yeah. Stay positive and keep your chin up, and we'll follow you on Instagram and check out your photos.
And then doing a lot of binge watching too, of course. So
yeah. So what have you been watching? Don't say Ozark, because that would be weird.
I did watch that, obviously. I binge watched Arrested Development, which obviously Jason Bateman was the star in, and it took forever for me to watch it, because it was back in like the early 2000s, and people were like, yeah, you got to watch it. And I just never got into it. So this is a perfect time to sit down and watch it. Loved it. It was comedy gold. I could see why it was so popular. I just caught up on Billions on Showtime. New season comes out next Sunday, so really excited about that. I just watched all of season two of Afterlife with Ricky Gervais.
Yeah.
It's only six episodes a season, though. I'm like, man. And they're only 30 minutes apiece. But it's such a good show, and I'm hoping they're going to do a season three.
I haven't seen season two yet, but I'll probably watch that tonight. But yeah, it's a great show.
Yeah.
I've had a lot of time to watch things. I only watched The Sopranos recently, probably about a year or 2 years ago.
Okay.
And I binge watched it when I was cat sitting for my friend, actually. And I was like that with Ozark as well. It reminded me of, it's not similar to the story, but see when you watch a good show like The Walking Dead or, you know, something like The Sopranos, you just get totally hooked. Like, I was halfway through season three of Ozark, and I had to, like, I'm like, I need to go to my bed and get some sleep. I feel, like, dehydrated. I was getting migraines and stuff.
Started the whole, like anti-hero kind of thing. Because, you know, you found yourself rooting for Tony Soprano, who was a mob guy, and he was whacking off some of his best friends because they were turning on him. And then you got Breaking Bad, and which was another big phenomenon, obviously. Some people think that's the best show of all time. And, you know, that's another anti-hero. So the anti-hero is kind of it's definitely a big thing, thanks to The Sopranos, for sure.
Yeah. I noticed that looking at your CV, there's a couple of projects coming up, movies that you're going to be in. I've noticed that you're going to be in the new Walking Dead spinoff.
So I found out that I was getting cut from the spinoff, which is okay. You know, I mean, that happens. Also means I get to go back into the audition pool for maybe something even bigger. So I was okay with that, you know, and that's part of the business too.
Yeah.
But it's still on
there. Are you still getting a credit for it though? Are you still getting a credit?
I don't know why. I guess it's just on IMDb because, you know, I put it on there after I was done shooting it.
Yeah.
But I should probably take it off here soon. No?
No, don't take it off, man. I'd be wearing that on a t-shirt if I was you. Never take it off. So I've got another question. I've got a couple of questions here. One is from Neil Brachpiece, who is a stand-up comedian in Scotland, and he has asked, are you made aware of the storyline for the whole season, or are you just given your scenes for secrecy purposes?
So our showrunner, Chris Mundy, the last couple seasons, I've had a chat with him. So I know where my character's going. I haven't had the chat yet about season four. Should be soon. I'm looking forward to that to find out what's going to happen. Now, even though they have an outline of kind of what they want for Sam, but I don't get all this. We don't get all the scripts at once because they're writing it throughout the season. So they make changes. So we usually get the script, I would say 1 to 2 weeks ahead of shooting, usually.
Yeah.
Yeah. But that's a lot of shows are like that. You know, I mean, I remember the, the Marvel movies, The Walking Dead, I mean, Stranger Things, they all do that, I'm sure. Yeah.
So you've got 2 weeks to learn your lines?
Yeah, you know, give or take. I'll get the email from the second AD saying they're sending out the scripts. Yeah.
How's that experience? Is it quite nerve-wracking? I mean, you went to drama school, didn't you? So you're a trained actor, but
I was an English major, but I mean, I have a background in drama. Yeah. And my memory, I'm not very good at memorizing. Yeah. My brain doesn't keep it. Like, I take the ginkgo biloba pills for brain medicine, basically. Like streaming services, the writers, they're just phenomenal writers, and so it makes it easier when you look at it. If it's good writing, it'll be easy to kind of figure out, you know, what's the next line, where the scene's going. So that definitely helps.
Yeah. Well, that's awesome. So when you did Willy Wonka, was that in like university?
Yeah, that was an onstage musical in a community theater in Clemson, South Carolina, where I went to college.
Oh, awesome. What age are you, by the way? Because I couldn't find anything online.
Oh, does it not say what age I am? Oh,
no, couldn't find it.
I'll be 38 June 25th.
June 25th, I'm June 19th.
Oh, cool.
So what's your next thing that you think that you'll be working on? Obviously, if you need to keep it a secret, that's okay. But have you got any projects coming up?
Well, when everything got shut down, I was working on a project, and they're pretty secretive about it. So I wish I could tell you, but I had to sign an NDA for it. It's going to be good when it comes out eventually. People are going to love it. And it was great to be a part of. So I got to finish shooting that when we come back. So.
Well,
whenever that is, hopefully soon.
Yeah. Well, we'll need to just follow you on social media and keep our eyes peeled for it.
Yeah, yeah. Once I can, reveal what it is, I'll definitely post it on social media for sure.
Good, man. So I've got a couple of things here as well. Like, it's back to kind of Ozark. I'm big on mental health. I love trying to improve my mental health and my fitness and all that kind of stuff. And the recent character in Ozark, Ben Davis, who is probably a guy who played, who has bipolar, I would imagine that that's the closest thing to being real that I've ever seen from someone who plays someone with mental health problems.
Yeah.
I think it's just an amazing kind of window to how people struggle, and it was really moving, and it was a major part of that season. Has it been received well?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Tom Pelfrey, who plays Ben, incredible actor. Reminds me of a young John Malkovich. I think we're going to be hearing about him for quite some time. Yeah, he did some research when he got the role. I can't remember the book that he read, but there was a book about bipolar, the disease bipolar. And yeah, he just it was amazing how he brought it to life on screen. You know, from his first scene with this rage, but he can go from rage to laugh, you know, to just being a cut up, to being, he had to run the gambit of all the emotions, which is what people with bipolar have to deal with. And it's just amazing. And he knew what was going to, he knew the outcome of the character, you know, like when he talked to Chris, our showrunner. And yeah, he did a phenomenal job. And I think he's going to definitely, get some accolades for that come like award season for sure.
Yes, I mean the scene when in the taxi in the cab.
Oh yeah.
You know, if you can get an Oscar for that, that would get someone an Oscar. Like it was perfect kind of performance. Well,
if TV had Oscars.
Yeah. Yeah.
But like a Golden Globe for sure. I think when he gets nominated, that will be one of the, that'll be, you know, like they show 10, 15 seconds, like, and Tom Pelfrey for Ozark. I think that'll be the scene in the back of the taxi, would be a really good scene. Or the scene with him and Helen, and his blow up with her. That would be a good one too. You know, you'd have to beep out obviously some of the words for, for TV, but yeah, he's amazing.
Yeah, there's quite a lot of characters that I miss as well. Do you know who I loved? I loved the actor that played Tuck. He was fantastic. Oh,
yeah, yeah. I haven't actually met him, but Evan, I hear he's a really, really sweet guy. It's unfortunate that he wasn't back for season three. I'm hoping he comes back for season four if we have one.
Yeah,
I know he would love to be a part of it, and I know the cast would love for him to be a part of it. I think it had something to do with the fact that the Blue Cat Lodge wasn't in season three, you know, because he was working there in the show. So, yeah, I love the guy. I hope I get to meet him someday. And he's a huge fan of the show. Loves supporting everybody. So I hope he comes back to the
That'd be fantastic. That was the only thing that made me a wee bit sad, was Tuck wasn't in the new series, but I'm sure he'll be in the new one. So I don't want to keep you too long. We've probably done about 40 minutes, Kevin. I don't want to keep you all night.
You're good, man. I'm going to go to the grocery store after this, so no worries.
I keep asking you about Tom Cruise. You end up hanging your phone up.
Old TC.
Yeah, so are you going to go to the grocery store with a baseball bat and keep yourself safe, or is it okay?
It's not Walking Dead yet. I did get a mask finally, because it's tough to find. I had to make my own, and then my roommate, who's also an actor, she was able to get a hold of some masks, so she gave me one. So makes it easier going to the grocery store, even though some people, they're still not wearing them at the grocery store. And I'm thinking, we're never going to get out of this mess if you don't, you know, adhere to the recommendations, you know?
Yeah. It's been pretty a strange experience hearing Donald Trump saying about injecting bleach.
Oh my God. Insane.
Crazy.
I've seen some crazy, there was this interesting picture that somebody drew. Excuse me. Might have been a computer generated picture, but it had it was a naked Donald Trump, like this, and he had needles sticking in him, and then he had doctors in front of him. It was almost like he was King Kong. I can't unsee it. If you find it, it's something you can't unsee. It's like,
yeah, we'll stick that up. It's really strange as well, because the Prime Minister of the UK is Boris Johnson, and he's he looks like Donald Trump's cousin, like just equally as strange, and comes away with some crazy statements. Like at the start, he said, "Take it on the chin and herd mentality," and it's like having the chicken pox, you've got to catch it. And then he ended up catching it.
And then he got sick. Yeah.
Yeah, man. It's crazy.
But I guess he recovered though from it, right? Yeah. I know he was in the hospital, and it was apparently, people were worried about it. I wonder that would have been crazy if something had happened.
Yeah, he was in intensive care. Look at me talking like I know him, like I'm best mate to him. He was in intensive care, and I think he's just in self-isolation now, but he's not been heard from or seen in a couple of weeks.
Yeah, I guess they're kind of keeping him, under lock and key, you know?
Yeah, there'll be a few conspiracy theories cutting about, because a lot of people still believe that the earth is flat and the royal family are lizards. So I'm sure they'll say that Boris is a clone or something.
Did you hear about Kim Jong-un? Like, is he dead? Like, I see articles and nobody's saying, like, it's not on CNN or anything yet. So, but I keep seeing articles like, oh, Kim Jong-un is dead.
But yeah, I've seen that.
They must be keeping that under wraps. Like, North Korea probably doesn't want that getting out if he is.
Yeah, that would be crazy if he was dead. I mean, imagine that it was just this guy with a wig on and a pair of glasses pretending that it was him doing press calls. I think that's pretty serious.
I don't know if that would be a good, is that a good thing or a bad thing if he's dead? Because the regime itself is the problem.
Yeah,
and he was the head of the regime, but I mean, you cut off, I don't know if you cut off the head of this situation, it's gonna crumble. Somebody will just take their place, and you know, it's a bizarre time.
That is bizarre. What if he died because he injected bleach? Imagine it was that.
I don't even think he was 30 years old. Like, he's really, really young.
Wow.
I think he's really young. Yeah.
Time has not been kind to him then, because he's got a Benjamin Button kind of thing going on.
Yeah. Yeah.
He thought he was in his 60s.
It's a crazy time right now, man. Who would have thought Kobe Bryant would have passed away earlier this year? Everybody's in lockdown. Like, and the year's not even halfway over yet. It's like, come on, can we get to 2021?
Yeah. And the Kobe Bryant passing away, in Scotland, basketball is not a big thing in Scotland. And when he passed away, it even shocked Scotland. You know, it was such a major thing, but that seems so long ago now, considering all this stuff.
Yeah, I know. Like, you wouldn't even know that we have an election here coming up in November.
Yeah,
I mean, Joe Biden versus Trump. I mean, if this wasn't going on, that would be what people would be talking about. Like, they would be out campaigning, and I mean, it's already almost May. Was it May, June, July, August, September, October? Yeah, it's like 7 months away from us, you know, finding out who the next president's going to be or if he's going to get another 4 years.
I mean, Joe, I'm first name terms with Joe because he's my best friend as well, but he's looking rough, isn't he? He's looking...
Yeah, yeah. But, you know, I think he can get the job done. We just got to... I know I don't want to get all political here, but...
Yeah.
But I'm not a fan of Trump. I'll just say that. Let's just throw it out there. So...
Yeah, I think any good person with a good heart is not a fan of Trump. It's absolutely insane times.
Yeah, it's crazy. Don't want to get too political, I know, on a podcast, because I know you got fans from both sides of the aisles. So I love all the fans on the right, on the left, just so everybody knows.
Don't worry,
everybody
Kevin.
Has an opinion.
I'm a fucking idiot. Don't worry. All my fans are just... We just love The Walking Dead and stuff, don't worry. I had a Scottish comedian yesterday, we were talking about Scottish politics and stuff, and I was like, don't go there, because it's the same, it completely splits opinion, but sometimes you just need to talk about it for therapeutic reasons as well, yeah. You need to get it off your chest.
It's a rabbit hole too, though, once you start to, it's just like,
yeah,
you can just kind of go deep, yeah.
You'll be getting DMs on Twitter now from people saying, check out this Flat Earth video. Look into it. It's real. What do you think? I hope you're not a Flat Earther, by the way. I'm sorry if you are.
Oh, no. I know some, I don't know people personally, but I've heard of like some people in the industry, or like, I think a basketball player said he was a flat earther guy. But yeah, I don't know. I mean, we've been to space. I mean, it's not it. So you would be able to tell from space.
That's the people that are injecting bleach though. So kind of balances out, doesn't it?
Keeps the bleach company in business.
Yeah, that's what we should do. We should buy shares in bleach and quit acting.
Yeah.
Have you ever been to Scotland or the UK?
No, I haven't been out of the States. I want to. My buddy who got me into CrossFit, and we worked at a restaurant together, he's getting married in the UK next year. So I'm looking forward to that. So I'll be going then. Hopefully, I mean, I would love to go sooner because, you know, when you travel abroad, it just opens up your mind to like, oh, wow, it's different here, you know. So it would be cool to visit Scotland, the UK. Yeah, just so hopefully soon would be nice.
You would be welcomed, and if Scott Squad's coming back for another series, there's a part there for you, mate, if you want it.
Yeah, man, if I get to come in town, we should definitely hang out. You have to take me to some pubs and stuff, yeah.
Yeah, no bother, I'll show you about. I'll take you to a Celtic game, a soccer match.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, soccer, I know soccer's big over there.
Yes, soccer's the main one. Peter Mullen, he's a Celtic fan as well. So you're based in Atlanta just now?
Mm-hmm. That's where I live.
Yeah. You've always been there?
I moved here in late 2015.
Yeah. Is that basketball? Is that like a basketball city?
The South, I mean, is football, really.
Yeah.
They have the Atlanta Falcons. We have the Atlanta Braves. I'm a big Braves fan. But I grew up in South Carolina, so I grew up in the Carolinas, so I'm a Carolina Panthers fan. So I don't pull for the Falcons.
Yeah.
Or the Hawks. I'm a Hornets fan, Charlotte Hornets. So, yeah.
So you've got a couple of teams.
Yeah. And then we also have Atlanta United, which is a big our big soccer MLS team, which we have a really good following there. They packed the Mercedes-Benz Stadium. I've never been, but I have friends that have gone, and they say it's a crazy, crazy time. And soccer fans are, you know, very energetic. I don't know how it's not as big here as it is in other countries, you know. It's
yeah.
But Yeah. Hopefully, the World Cup again? It's every 4 years, right? So
every 4 years, yeah. So I'm not too sure what's happening now, but I'm not too sure where it is. I think it might be, Andrew, do you remember where it is? I think it's in Dubai. I can't remember.
When was the last World Cup? Was it 3 years ago already? Because I know it was when I was working at the restaurant, and that's been over 2 years. So, yeah, I was super disappointed when the U.S. didn't make it to the tournament. I was like, are you kidding me? How did we not make it to the World Cup? It was insane. Like, it was, yeah. It was a travesty. It was embarrassing. It was all over ESPN, you know, even though soccer isn't huge here. I mean, when we didn't make it to the World Cup, that was big news. So yeah, hopefully that doesn't happen again.
But the female team won the World Cup, didn't they?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Who's the captain again? She's got pink hair.
Yeah. I can't remember her name, but she's a big activist. She's done a lot for like communities and things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also very funny because they are amazing at trolling British people. Like, because they were so good. They were winning. I'm probably going to lose a couple of fans saying this, but the English football team, they have this superior complex. And, you know, America just beat them quite easily. So they were standing outside the team bus and pretending that they were drinking tea and stuff. It was very funny.
Was that the finals? Did they play them in the finals?
Yes, I think it may have been the semi-final or something. I can't remember, but okay. Yeah, it was good. The American female football team reminded me of like WWE wrestlers. You're a WWE fan?
I loved it when I was in high school, like during the whole Attitude Era thing. Yeah. So Stone Cold, The Rock, Triple H, I mean, those like were my guys. So I watch it now with my buddies, my buddy Nick, who got me into CrossFit, him and another buddy of ours, Tyler. We would get together and watch like the pay-per-views. So it sucked when we couldn't get together or watch WrestleMania. We had planned on watching WrestleMania. And yeah. I haven't even watched it. I just can't bring myself to watch it because it's an empty arena. It's just, I feel bad for, your guy, Drew McIntyre.
Yeah.
Like for him to finally get over, you know, like they say in wrestling because obviously it's scripted, but to get that, you know, the belt, and he had to get it to an empty arena. I told my buddy, I was like, this just isn't fair to Drew McIntyre. I mean, he's like one of the biggest names now. Like when all this, like when he won the Royal Rumble, everybody was jacked and excited. And I'm sure you guys were too. I saw some videos of some pubs were pretty ecstatic when he won.
Yeah.
With the Claymore. Did he win with the Claymore kick? I can't remember.
Yeah. I mean, it's so surreal that he won it. It was sad that there wasn't an audience there. I don't really watch it anymore either. I was in Attitude Era. I'm having a stroke. I was an Attitude kind of kid. I was a British Bulldog, Owen Hart, you know, the Hart Foundation.
Yeah.
To see a Scottish guy win it was unbelievable, but in an empty arena was crazy. But we celebrated that like a football win, like a soccer.
I
know.
I saw some of the YouTube videos, and I was like, man, nice. Drew McIntyre would love that.
Yeah, it's so strange as well because I've met him before through a friend of a friend.
Oh,
it's
sweet.
Just like so surreal seeing someone from a small part of Scotland, like rise to the top of WWE. It's kind of like that with, I mean, obviously Peter Mullen's a genius, but
yeah,
that's the same thing. You're like, no way, he's on like in Hollywood movies and stuff. It's just strange.
Yeah, Peter Mullen's awesome. Yeah, he was getting knocked off in season two was like, oh no, but
yeah,
his run on there was incredible. So I got to meet him once. We never had any scenes together, which is probably good for Sam. You know, I think if I ever met Darlene or Jacob, then that's not a good sign. But yeah, I got to meet him at one of the rap parties. He was a nice guy. Yeah.
Yeah, he's a good guy. Talented actor, some amazing stuff. Have you ever seen, are you aware of his work that he's done in the UK? Some of the films that he's done, like Tyrannosaur and that kind of stuff?
No, I mean, I've probably seen things that he's been in the past and just forgot. I mean, I saw him in last season of Westworld for a little bit. And, you know, he was in, I think, the last episode of Westworld or the episode before. But, yeah, he's an awesome actor.
Yeah. I've got another question here I'll ask you quickly. It reminds me of Darlene. Someone said in season four, do you think there'll be a love interest or something similar? Like what happened with Darlene?
After her and Wyatt kind of has happened?
Yeah.
Huh.
I almost instantly regretted asking you that there.
Yeah, I didn't know how they were going to do that I thought it was just going to be something that's kind of implied or you're just kind of supposed to think maybe something's going on. But then, they have a scene where they're full on in bed and knocking boots, man. It's,
They make a good couple, though.
Yeah, I think they're going to – I think that'll be an interesting storyline in season four if we have one, you know.
So is there anything else that you would like to say before we wrap it up? I'll let you get to the shops. I don't want to keep you all night. That's an hour we've done now. So
yeah, man, this has been fun. I would just say to everybody that's listening, I know it's cliche, but stay healthy, stay safe. I think we're going to all get out of this soon. We've already been, it's almost been 2 months now. Middle of March, almost May now. So close to 2 months. I think the light at the end of the tunnel is, it gets closer each day. So we just got to power through, find things to, keep us sane. Binge watch Ozark, all kinds of shows, keep your mind right, go outside, do some photography. That keeps me busy. So we'll get out of this.
Yeah. You're a good man. Keep your chin up and I wish you all the best in life. Congrats. Thanks, on Ozark. And I'm always here for a chat if you're bored.
Yeah, man. Thank you. You're awesome. I'm glad, you started following me, man. What was it like? Was it in season one or two that you,
season one.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm definitely down to do another podcast.
Anytime. I'm not doing CrossFit though. I'm not that fit, but I'll see what I can do.
No, we can do some Zoom CrossFit classes. Yeah.
So everyone get on Netflix, check out Ozark. What's your Twitter handle?
It is a Kevin_L_Johnson. And then Instagram is the Kevin L. Johnson. Still trying to get verified on Instagram. Hopefully that'll happen. You have to wait every 30 days, so I got to do it May 15th. So
yeah.
I don't know why I'm not verified yet on there, but it is what it is.
Same with Twitter, because you've only got a couple of thousand followers. What is it, 3,000 followers or something?
I've got a little over 2,500. I know it's tough, man. I get some every now and then each day, but I don't know how people, you have like how many? Like you have like 15,000, 20,000 followers?
No, it's about 14,000.
14,000. That's amazing. Like I feel like I'm going to have to go like 6 or 7 seasons for people to start.
But that's the difference. You're too busy working. I'm not a working actor, so I'm just reading shit 24 hours a day.
But no, I mean, that's good that you got a bunch of followers. I mean, you know, it's part of the business now, you know. It's I think it goes into not all the casting for shows and movies, but a lot of producers like to see, oh, well, this person has a built-in audience. So when they come aboard our TV show or our movie, that's a certain amount of people that are going to go see the movie or watch the show. So yeah. It's just something that you got to get used to and get better at, you know. So I've been working at it. So, and this downtime was why I'm like on everybody's on Instagram and Twitter like constantly now. So,
yeah,
you know, got to take advantage of it.
Start your own podcast or do Instagram live videos or
yeah,
anything, man. You've got a fan base there, mate.
Yeah, that's true. I'd come up with something.
Yeah. Right. Well, Kevin, I hope you have a good night. I'll send you the podcast when it's done. I'll tag you and all that kind of stuff. And thank you for a great chat. It's just been really nice to get to know you.
Absolutely. Same here, man. We'll have to do it again. No doubt.
Thank you. Take care.
All right, Derek.
You are just wrap that up, Andrew.
Oh,
this is. Aye, aye.